Oh my gosh, I just tried to move the microphone while getting started. Hi, hello. Okay, historians, let's get going. So we're going to review the big stuff you need to know when it comes to this learning objective. U2A, I can explain in my own words what natural rights are and how the concept influenced revolutions and movements from 1760 to today. So the big part is going to be that, like, how does this idea of natural rights influence revolutions and rebellions? So let's get started and let's remember what natural rights are. Natural rights is this idea that people are born with certain rights that cannot be taken away from them and that no government has the right to take away from you. And there have been different philosophical debates and arguments about what these things are, but they're the fundamental or universal or inalienable rights, the things that all people deserve. And we normally think of things like freedom of religion or freedom of speech, but a lot of times those natural rights, those rights that people fight for and believe all people deserve are more complex than just those. And so we're going to take a look at those. And you'll also see here that legal rights are those that are given to a person by a legal system. They can be modified, repealed, or restrained by human laws. And we'll see that in order for natural rights to be protected, they often have to be written into some kind of foundational document or within the legal system to ensure that they are protected. So the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was how we first started exploring this unit. And we looked at it because it was a document created by the United Nations. Now, the United Nations is an organization of countries that hold each other accountable and hold, you know, the world accountable as much as they can. They don't really have a lot of legal say or the ability to, truly enforce things, but they come together and they meet and they discuss world issues and they try and come to agreements on those world issues in order to hold each other accountable. Now, part of why it was created was to prevent another world war from occurring. And the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a document that was created after World War II and the Holocaust. They saw the atrocities of the Holocaust and of World War II and really believed that there needed to be a declaration of rights to try and prevent things like this from happening again, prevent the sort of, racism and anti-Semitism and the destruction of an entire people based on their religious beliefs that had to be stopped and people had to be protected. And so the documents created by the United Nations, it lists rights it believes should be guaranteed to all people everywhere, and it's been updated throughout history. And again, World War II and the Holocaust are really going to be the reasons why it's created. So when we start looking at historical examples of times people have fought for rights, we want to look at the French Revolution as our main one. It's not the first one, but it's going to be the main one we use to compare other revolutions to. It begins in 1789 in France. And France was in debt from the Seven Years' War, and they had paid a lot of money and given a lot of resources to the American Revolution, which was fighting for a more representative government, right? They were taking those Enlightenment ideas of people having a say within the government and being a part of the government. And France was like giving money. The French king was giving money to the American Revolution to support the revolutionaries against the British, because France and the British, they fight all the time. That's not anymore, but they did all the time. There was social and economic classes that were not fairly representative, and the taxation was on the third estate. The majority of taxation happened to what was called the third estate, which is that social economic class. And they had the highest percentage of the population. They were 98% of the population. But when it came time for the king to call together representatives from the three estates, remember, estates are the social economic classes, everyone had an equal, every group had an equal say, not every part of the population. So the first estate got one vote, the second estate got one vote, and the third estate got one vote. Even though the third estate made up 98% of the population, they had the same amount of power as groups that made up 0.5 and 1.5% of the population. And so we see that they were fighting for the chance to be fairly represented within their government and for all laws to apply equally. So they didn't want these rigid social and economic classes that made it difficult for commoners to have a say. Instead, they wanted a representative government that allowed for a more democratic approach where everyone was equally represented within the government. And when we talk about who was involved, we want to remember the three estates. We also remember that King Louis XVI was king at the time of this, and he is removed and his head is removed, he's beheaded, in order to ensure that the monarchy is destroyed, and because of the Reign of Terror and the Law of Suspects, those being against the revolution during this time. The American Revolution, we see, starts in 1776 in what are known as the American colonies. So these are the British colonies in North America, but we call them the American colonies because we're America. The British were in debt because of the Seven Years' War against the French, and they decide to tax the American colonists with things like the Stamp Act and the Sugar Act. And even though the colonists had zero representation in Parliament, so Parliament's the part of the British government that makes the laws, and they tend to be a representative part of the government where people have someone there representing their views or opinions. But the colonists didn't have anyone to represent them in Parliament. They weren't allowed to have representatives in Parliament. And so the colonists started protesting, asking for that representation. And instead of giving the colonists a voice, the British government started passing even harsher laws and rules and restrictions on them. And so the colonists just were like, we'll just have a revolution. We're going to declare independence and have a revolution. And when we talk about who was involved and what rights they were fighting for, representation in government was the biggest goal. But they also wanted all citizens equal under the law and all citizens to have a say in government. They wanted freedom of speech and freedom of religion and freedom of the press. It is important to remember that when we say citizens here, a large chunk of the population is enslaved. Women are not considered to have the same rights as men, and indigenous people are completely left out and forgotten after this revolution occurs. And so when we talk about who is involved, we want to talk about the British government, Parliament, King George III, and the American colonists. Also, you should watch Hamilton, because that's what these GIFs are from, and it has to do with this, so go watch Hamilton. The Latin American revolutions began in 1776 in the American colonies. That is a typo. They happen in the 1800s. Big typo there. We're just going to roll with it, though, because I've already re-recorded this four times, and this is just a quick review video. All right, what were the causes? No free trade for the colonies, discrimination against the Creoles, who were of European ancestry, but were not allowed to hold the same power as those who were born in Europe. So there was the Peninsulares, who were born in Europe and were brought to the Spanish colonies and were able to have positions of power, where the Creoles were of European descent but weren't allowed to have any form of like political power. And don't even get me started about the massive racial, social hierarchy that was created that denied power and wealth to everybody else, people of African descent, indigenous people, people of mixed race, completely denied rights based on this very rigid, very strict social hierarchy based on race. And so the Creoles wanted more rights and they wanted more social, economic, and political power. They saw other people getting rid of their colonial rule, especially when they looked at the Haitian Revolution. And they wanted to self-govern and get rid of Spain and Spanish control. And when they look at the American Revolution, they see people getting rid of their colonial rule, and they wanted to self-govern and have control. They did also want to maintain the sort of racist hierarchy, but they wanted the Creoles in power instead of the Peninsulares in power. So people of European descent in power instead of people who are actually from Europe in power. With the Haitian Revolution, it began in 1791 on the French colony known as Saint-Domingue. Domingue, I just said that word wrong. It's fine. The French Revolution and the Declarations of Rights, Man and Citizen, led at first to white planters wanting independence. Again, seeing like the American Revolution being like, maybe we can get in on like not having that colonial rule and being able to self-govern and being able to like take care of ourselves more. But Africans living in Saint-Domingue and people of African descent realize that like if the white planters win, their treatment will become exponentially worse. And so we see both free and enslaved peoples rising up and asking to self-govern and end slavery and ensure property rights for all people and have the right to self-govern. Right? And a bunch of different groups get involved with this because it's really important to remember that it was one of the most successful plantation systems in the Americas during this time period. It was making a ton of money. And more about 80% of the population on the island were enslaved people. And this is the first time we've seen there were plenty of other, which I should say this very clearly, plenty of other attempts at slave rebellions and revolts, but this is the first time where we see them, the rebellion lead to full autonomy of the government, and enslaved people getting full freedom and being able to rule within the government as well. So guess what? This quick video, I just went through all of the things, not all. There's one part at the end you have to do the answers for, but I basically went through almost all of the answers for this study guide. So go do your study guide if you haven't done it yet. Almost all the answers are in this video. I just went over them for you. You can pause it. You can go back. You might want more detail than what I wrote because I talked a lot more than what I had written on the slides. But if you had no idea where to start, there's all the info for you. Have a wonderful day, guys. You got this.